ICON 2013. Our last talk for this session is being presented by Selena Deckelmann, who is going to be talking about what teachers really need from us. Please make her welcome.
Thank you. Yes, so my name is Selena. I work for Mozilla on this thing called crashstats.mozilla.com for my day job. Mostly involves wrangling databases and looking at every time your browser crashes so you can, you know, put in, hi Selena, when Firefox crashes. I'm also a major contributor to PostgreSQL. And I helped found PyLadies PDX back in September. Yes, and there are a few folks from Portland here in the house today. Yay! We're up to about 100 members now, and it's very, very exciting. Anyway, so when I was thinking today, well, first, actually, before I start, how many people here are teachers? Wow, that's so awesome. I expect to hear from all of you. But as I was thinking today about what this talk was really about, I realized that it was something like, and this is, might sound a little weird, but it was something like a love letter to the importance of the human connections that we have to one another in open source, and also about how much I believe in the small incremental actions that each one of us take to make these communities so wonderful and welcoming. So that's kind of what this talk is going to be about, my journey to get there. And it's also a promise that reaching out to teachers is totally worth your time. That I really see this as a social change that needs to happen in our open source communities to make them more welcoming and to incorporate more teachers into our work. So some of the reasons why I think this is true are that teachers are absolutely natural allies to us in open source. They're optimists, which I think is proven just based on their paychecks alone. They are incredibly resource constrained from the perspective of upgrading machines, providing for the students in the schools, and just budgets just in general. They also typically don't get to teach computer science all the time. It's typically an elective in most states, and they don't necessarily know that if they're, you know, whether they're going to teach CS or algebra or maybe get pushed into the sciences or some other, whatever they're actually certified in, what they're going to teach. They are experts in their field, right? They've spent thousands of hours teaching, 30 students at a time to do something, and in particular teaching absolute beginners how to do things. And they also love learning communities, which all of our open source communities are learning communities. We're all teaching each other, we're all teaching ourselves all the time new things, and that's also what teachers do. And there are some ways that they absolutely need help. They're incredibly underfunded, both from the salary perspective and also from the resources in the classroom perspective. Their jobs are often at risk. I've talked a little bit about this in a recent blog post. You know, the number of CS classes in the United States has been dropping over the last few years. Teachers are generally isolated in their work. It's just kind of the nature of teaching as a profession in the United States. They typically have about 1 hour of prep time for 7 hours of class, or some of the lucky ones have 2 hours of prep for 6 hours of class each day. And they don't have a lot of time to go and like seek out other teachers to review their lessons or something like that. And they typically never have a computer science colleague in their same school or even in their same district. They're typically not at their computers. They're mostly really not into social networking for work purposes. You know, they might have a Facebook account, but it's not like they're, teachering it up on Facebook. And if you want to know more kind of about the state of K-12 computer science education in the United States, you can check out that link there. I did a keynote at DjangoCon where I went really into a lot of depth into some of the individual, like the personal and the political problems that we have right now with that in the US. So But my journey, you know, that led me to give this talk and also to think quite a bit about how I wanted more teachers in my open source communities was I had the opportunity to teach a lesson about algorithms. And was asked to do this as part of for those of you who were here for the Open Hatch panel just now, it was a PyLadies and Open Hatch related workshop. And we had about 30 women, it might have been 32, and they had all committed to coming for a weekend and learning introductory Python stuff. And we needed to kind of explain this idea of algorithms to them. So, like all naive teachers, I think, my first instinct here was to go to Wikipedia, find some impressive algorithm on Wikipedia, and I was going to teach the hell out of that to these students. And it turns out, actually, I'm married to a teacher, so I ran this idea by him. And he started asking me, you know, some important questions. And the ones that stuck with me were, you know, what's the goal? Who's the audience? What should they know at the end? You know, like maybe I should consider this stuff. So I started thinking this through, and I realized some important things about this Wikipedia lesson that I was going to teach. And the first thing that I wanted the students to know was that they shouldn't be afraid. Right? These are people that have never programmed before. A lot of them have math anxiety. There's actually a great NPR story recently about math anxiety and what it does to people's future in math. So anyway, I wanted to help them understand that algorithms aren't scary. You know, it's not that much math. And so I want to start out with that. And so at that point, I threw out the idea to use Wikipedia for this lesson because really the first person that I showed that to, which was my husband, was terrified. And then I thought about, okay, who really is this audience that I'm speaking to? And it was, you know, like I said, largely people who hadn't programmed before or people who had never programmed in Python. And then finally I came to, okay, what do I actually want them to know at the end of this lesson? And the key thing was knowing how to decompose problems, right? Like, this is a fundamental programmer thing. We take big, hairy problems and we decompose them into little parts. And particularly in Python, this is like a great thing that we all do, right? We make these little functions and they do awesome things. So I needed to teach them, you know, this process. How do we go through this? And I also wanted to give them a memorable and a relevant definition of what algorithms actually were. So what I came up with, well, really it was a collaboration with a few different people. We decided to teach algorithms as recipes. And our introductory lesson to this was to demonstrate making a peanut butter and jelly sandwich with me as a programmer and my friend Michelle as the computer. And so she had a jar of peanut butter, a knife, and some bread. And I said, put the peanut butter on the bread. So she took the jar and she stuck it on top of the pieces of bread, right? That's the first action. And I was like, oh, man, crap. You know, no, I actually have to give you more specific instructions, you know, to get you to understand, you, the computer, to understand what it is that I actually want you to do. And then after that, we had a workshop where we had the women go and write out algorithms for getting themselves from the airport to home using a bunch of different methods of transit. And so at that point, they started learning some flow control, some if-then-else stuff. They started making loops, like if you call your friend and they don't pick up, maybe you should try again. Maybe there's some back off to that algorithm. They came up with an amazing array of common, like, things that I commonly use in my own programming, right? Without them knowing any programming, they came up with all of these techniques. Man, it was amazing. So this is a picture from that workshop. Like I came out of it, I was glowing. I was so excited. This was like the best lesson ever. There were lots of things that I had meant to teach also that I didn't quite make it in there because we ran out of time, but I was so stoked. And I really wanted to do it again. So the next day, I started kind of thinking about what had happened, and I realized that I totally wasn't sure how I was going to do it again. Like, that lesson turned out really great, but I thought about other topics, more complex topics, more important things that I wanted them to learn, and I just really wasn't sure how to do it. And I was like, you know, I could use an expert. I could use some expert help in this. And I thought hard, this is funny too, with my husband sitting next to me, who is it out there in the world that teaches 30 plus students at a time, you know, beginners, and they do this really efficiently? Well, you know, duh. Yeah. K through 12 teachers, right? And so anyway, that's kind of how I started down this path. And my husband really encouraged me. My husband's looming large in this story because I do collaborate a lot with him on lessons. But initially I was like, okay, I'm gonna go out and I'm gonna talk to people. I'm totally gonna do that. But then, you know, as I was sitting there at my computer, I was like, talking's kind of scary. I don't know if I can do that. So instead, what I'm going to do is I'm going to read. I'm going to read the crap out of a lot of really important education-related materials. And I'd previously read this book called Unlocking the Clubhouse. Any of you here familiar with that book? Yeah. So that's good stuff. And the reason why I'd read it is because I was interested in diversity outreach. I wanted to get more women at my user groups. I wanted to hire women at the companies that I was working at. So I was hoping, you know, or hoping to learn a lot from that, and I did. And then so I was familiar with Jane Margolis, and she's written another book. It's called Stuck in the Shallow End, and how many of you here have read that? There's not as many. Well, those of you who enjoyed Unlocking the Clubhouse, Stuck in the Shallow End is an amazing, you know, second book to read. And this is specifically about high school education and what a group of researchers did in LA and I think maybe one other school district to try to come up with a comprehensive computer science curriculum that address, you know, a lot of the kind of unknown unknowns about computer science education. It's a great read. And they also, in addition to talking about the students, they talked a lot about the teachers, what things the teachers needed, what kind of support that they needed from their administration, you know, what were the gaps in the teachers' education and in certification. And that led me to reading the Running on Empty report. Which is an amazing document that the ACM and the Computer Science Teachers Association put together that discusses all 50 states. They went through every single state. It took them 2 years, and they have some very funny comments in the PDF about how difficult it was to even figure out who in each state they should talk to find out about CS education. But anyway, they went through and they assessed exactly what are the standards in each state, what's the number of teachers that are certified to teach computer science, and kind of where, you know, what direction is CS education going, and that also was a great read. So I read that, I was like really fired up, I was like, oh man, you know, we need to change everything. Need to get my legislators. I wrote letters to my legislators. I even cornered one on a plane one time. It was really great. And he was sitting in the middle seat. It was so awesome. I was like, hey, have you read this report? And I'm like showing it to him. Anyway, he's trying to read his paper. So I ended up giving a couple keynotes on that CSTA thing, and because I gave those talks, a couple teachers came up and talked to me, and I was like, whoa, this is kind of cool. They actually came and talked to me. There's only like two, you know, I met a couple at that point and started these conversations. You know, what is it like? The first one was in Germany. You know, what is it like to be a computer science teacher in Germany, and what do you think is going to happen next? So, you know, I only got two, so I decided maybe I should go local. You know, maybe I should look around in my own backyard. And I investigated Oregon. There's about 200, there's a little over 200 districts in Oregon. There's about 40 computer science programs in the state. There is no commonly recognized CS certification. There's a computer technology certification, but that's not the same thing as computer science, and most of the teachers who are teaching CS don't have it. And these programs are elective and may not be taught every year, so it's kind of challenging to get in touch with these teachers. So, just to recap my process so far. I'm asking friends, I'm giving talks at conferences. I didn't say this, but I actually called the Computer Science Teachers Association up and I talked to Chris Stevenson on the phone, and you know, she mostly asked me like, how can I get in touch with more people like you? And I was like, well, you could join a mailing list. But anyway, so we had these conversations, but I didn't really actually meet any other computer science teachers as a result of that. And so then I decided, all right, I'm just gonna use Twitter. So I started tweeting, and that eventually led me to some Facebook groups. And then I finally was introduced to this nonprofit called TechStart in Oregon, which is trying to connect professionals with teachers. And they sent out an email to this amazing teacher. His name's Chris Bartlow. And he's got a four-year program at Wilson High School in the Portland area that he's built up over the last 5 or 6 years. And so he and I started talking. We've got these plans for collaboration now. And that meeting was so inspiring that I just decided, all right, I'm done sitting on my hands and just giving talks. I'm just going to start emailing schools directly. And asking them to please just introduce me to someone that knows something about this. And that has by far been the most effective thing to do. I've gotten four more contacts, had three meetings so far, got another one scheduled for when I've gotten back. So that brings us, for those of you who are attempting to count along, 9. And there's actually more than 9 of you here, so that's great. I've set up 9 of these meetings with these teachers and had these in-depth conversations with them about, you know, their teaching, the challenges that they're facing, and what, if anything, I could do to really help them. So the reason why I'm telling you this story is because this is the start, in my opinion. You know, I'm going to show you the link to the Python Education Summit wiki page that was just put up, because there was one of those this past week. But we're just starting to reach out to K-12 in a way I think that works for them. And I think that way really is about us connecting with them as people, and not necessarily about software itself. Professional to professional, how do you do your job, and how can we exchange knowledge in a way that helps both of us. So I'm thinking of this as Rev Zero, of this human API that I think that we have to build up, because that's, I think, the only way that we're really going to get a lot of these folks into our communities. So yeah, so I'm really putting forth a method that I think will work for connecting with teachers about ideas and in person with them, rather than really about the software. So this is like 5 steps, basically, a 5-step how-to. And the first piece of that is the empathy for what teachers do. And for me, that first step was trying to teach something to an absolute beginner, to someone who didn't understand what a directory was. Wow, that was an eye-opener, right? Like, I'm trying to get them to install Python, and they're like, you want me to do what, where, like, type what? You know, they just really, like, I had to go back to some fundamentals that I hadn't really thought about in many, many years. Another point of empathy is asking people to use my documentation, particularly documentation that I'd written a long time ago, which sometimes led me to use my own documentation, which is pretty terrifying. But sitting down with someone as they are reading through things that you've written and just watching their reactions to things and really like taking time to sort of quietly observe, you learn so much about how other people learn and the little things that you can do to make that so much easier for them. Another thing that I'm really fond of, I'm probably overly fond of this, but research, I think that's probably actually something I have in common with a lot of you here, is doing a lot of reading about what it is that teachers have to deal with. The ACM and the Computer Science Teachers Association are great resources. You don't have to be a certified teacher to join the CSTA, and they have a pretty low volume mailing list that they send out, things that they're up to, things that teachers are doing, and new reports that they've published, and it's totally worth joining. The Running on Empty report in particular, I highly recommend, if you haven't read it, like, go ahead, seek it out, read it. And then another thing that I've found incredibly useful is reading through U.S. Census data about jobs. There's these great reports that the Bureau of, I should have actually put a link here to that, but there's these great reports about projections, you know, of how many jobs that we're going to need in a lot of different industries, and in particular computer science, and it really helps underscore why we need people to learn how to teach this stuff, and we need that very soon. And then for those of you that are willing to go out and meet with teachers, and I'm telling you, it's totally worth it. It's totally worth your time to do this. Some of the people that I met at DjangoCon and I came up with a set of questions so that you can start this conversation sort of, you know, not really interview style, but at least give you something to say other than to just be like, hi. you're a teacher. Nice to meet you. You know, so we came up with this set of questions that you can ask to kind of learn more about their classroom, learn more about them as a professional, and start to share some of the things that you know as well, and then find them, which can be a little bit challenging. But how many of you here have seen code.org? Yeah, okay, so some of you haven't, but a lot of you have, yay. So code.org has a feature on it where you can search in your local area for places where computer science is being taught in high schools. And that is actually how I found the last four teachers, was just by going to that, finding the high school, and sending an email to that high school, and specific teachers trying to find people to talk to. And then once you have, you know, made these connections with people, figuring out what your next actions are going to be is a really critical part to building up these relationships. And one thing that every single teacher has asked me to do is come and give a short presentation in their class. And really, they're interested in anything because it's so relevant to the students to see someone who is working in the industry speak to them. It doesn't actually matter too much what you talk about, but you know, tell them about your job, what you love about your work, and that's really what the teachers tend to want to have in the classroom. Meeting with teachers periodically, I think, is super important. Again, like, I think that because of the nature of our work, and we have a lot more spare time, and the teachers themselves are not going, I think anyway, at least to this point, are probably not going to have enough time to go out and do the types of social networking things and have the online connections that we have. So if we can be that glue, that's usually beneficial to them. I've already connected three teachers that never even knew about each other's work, just in my own backyard with this. Another thing that I've found that the teachers enjoy is swapping lessons. So these lessons that I'm teaching, I've been teaching classes with Pi Ladies, and you know, we're going over Git basics, which is a little complicated, but you know, we're working through it, and the introduction to the command line. And these are things that are not part of the standard curriculum for example, AP Computer Science. First of all, you're using Windows, so it's a very different working environment. And second, the teachers don't have a lot of contact with IT professionals, and so they don't necessarily know what the most current job skills that the kids are going to use. And some of the kids go directly from high school into jobs, so they love being able to see what these lessons are that people are teaching in these adult education classes, because it's hugely, hugely relevant to the students. Another thing is that people often want to go and teach in schools. And I think that's great, but also I would highly recommend practicing your lessons on other adults, particularly other adults who aren't part of your industry and don't really know what you're talking about, because you're going to get some really honest reactions from them about your lessons and get some really great immediate feedback on the effectiveness of it, and then that turns into really great material for other teachers and your fellow colleagues here in open source. And then another thing that I would highly recommend if you are teaching, how many of you here actually are teaching to adults, teaching classes? Yeah, awesome. God, there's so many of us now, it's so amazing. One kind of important pedagogy thing is pre and post assessments. You know, do you have a way of knowing ahead of time, you know, what are the people who are coming to your class, what do they know? And then when they're leaving, did they learn what you intended them to learn? And there's quite a bit of science and a little bit of art in this, but it's something that teachers are experts at, and they can give you lots of amazing tools and techniques for the particular kinds of lessons that you're teaching in order to figure out, you know, was that effective or wasn't it? And finally, you know, when you're trying out this stuff, when you pick up tips from teachers, definitely find time to apply what you learn there. The stuff that I've gotten from the teachers that I know, there's so much, but probably the three most important things are here. And the first one is just simply connecting with your students. This is a huge important part of teaching, like that feeling of accomplishment and that feeling of validation that students get when they actually like master a concept. And a piece of that is just you as the teacher acknowledging them and having, you know, individual moments with each student in your class, and learning how to do that is super powerful and really helps with teaching. Second is testing your teaching, you know, and that comes down to the pre and the post assessments, checking for understanding, and finding ways of doing that in accurate and productive ways, hugely important. And then finally, finding ways to teach individual lessons more than once. This has been really difficult for me. Because I get through a lesson and I'm like, oh, I'm done, thank God, you know. But really the way that we get better at this stuff and the way that we make it really effective for other people, like a lot of you that are here that are teaching adults, is by doing it more than once and then sharing it out. And that's something that OpenHatch has done amazing things with RailsBridge, of course, as well. There's so many organizations now that are putting great materials out there and trying it over and over again, and certainly publishing your results and feedback that you get from your students. That's hugely, hugely important right now, because we're kind of in early days, honestly, for this. So in summary here, the things that I recommend, and I put this in a list in an order, but I don't think that you have to do this in this order. That's not what I mean by it. I just mean this is how I came to decide that I needed to have teachers in my professional life. I needed to have colleagues that I was discussing this stuff with on a regular basis. But, you know, it was empathy, like spending that time to try to teach absolute beginners, doing that research, you know, reading a few of these books that have been published now about beginners education and K-12. Making those individual contacts with teachers, and then spending the time to build up a real professional relationship with a teacher. And finally, apply what you learn from these teachers, because I think I don't know if I'm going to phrase this exactly in the right way, but one of the most gratifying things for a teacher is to see what they taught, see what they shared being applied out there in the field, showing that, you know, what they're sharing is really being spread around beyond them. So that's a gift that you can give to any person that you're working with in this way. So here's the link to the Python Education Summit wiki page. I talked briefly with Naomi today about it, and she said that she was going to post a link to a mailing list that they're setting up to have some discussions. They're planning on doing another one next year at PyCon, which you should all definitely go to. So I think that's worth it. And then if there's something, if you would like to kind of start down this path of connecting with teachers and creating these professional relationships, you know, bridging open source to K-12, I say go to code.org and find a school and just send a freaking email. Like, just go do that, right? And CC me, and I will do whatever I can to help you connect with that school. I put in this presentation some examples of some emails that I sent that were successful. I also have some examples of emails that weren't successful that I could also share. What I found out is that shorter is better. But, you know, I just said, I want to connect with these teachers, I want to talk with them, I'm teaching these classes, and I just want to ask, you know, what are these, you know, what's a high school teacher doing in their classroom? What do you think of open source? And is there anything that I can do as part of the Python community to make your classroom better or to help you as an individual? Here's another one that I sent. This was more of a cold call email, but I totally, you know, name dropped Mozilla. That was awesome. And I said, you know, I am willing to be a guest speaker in your classroom, which is awesome for a teacher, right? Because that's like a free lesson. And I was like, hey, you know, I will meet with you in person or on the phone. Because this is, you know, this is an important difference with teachers. Like a lot of them, they're like really like face-to-face kinds of people, or on the phone would be really convenient for them. Email is quite a bit harder because they don't often have a lot of time to just sit there and like, you know, type it out for you. So offer to come and meet them where they're at, for sure. And that one got me two teachers. So I'm hoping that some of you have some questions, because we're wrapping up a little early, but I just wanted to close with that reaching out to teachers is totally worth your time, and that I would like to do this with you all. I think this is the start. This is how we get people into our community that have some skills that we really need right now. And by acquiring these skills and sharing them with each other, I think that we're really going to be able to scale up the education, scale up our ability to educate people in a way that's been proven to work, right? Like, we have this public education system for a reason. It works. And, you know, they're the experts in how to do this. So, yeah, thanks.
So we seem to already have a few people lined up for questions for Selena. If you're interested in asking a question, join the queue behind the microphone back here. So, first question.
Are you familiar with the concept of flipped teaching, or flipped classroom, or flipped teaching? And do you have any comments on how that might fit into the work that you've been doing?
I'm not familiar with that term. Please briefly explain.
It's an experiment that's been done by a few high school teachers, where there's so much time that needs to be, where the time of the teacher has to be in front of everyone else. So instead of actually having my time being in front of you, we're now at a place in technology where we can actually have the stuff pre-prepared. And the lesson plan is, everything that you're going to see me do in front of class is now on a video that you do at home, and that's your homework.
Yes.
Or something similar. And when we come into the class, my time now is to answer questions, to walk around and
yeah,
help you as
and
I
coach.
Go.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a coaching process. It's been done experimentally in several high schools.
Yes.
It's been pretty, and I think with a community like this, we could actually build materials that could be used for a flipped classroom, and then we could then have it just assist the teachers with questions.
Yeah, I totally believe in that model. It's one of many models that I believe in, but I think that that's incredibly useful. The teacher I was talking with, Chris Bartlow, that's sort of how he works his classes. He is, you know, he'll do like, you know, 5 minutes of instruction to catch everybody up and get them on the same page, and then he's like, go, you know, and that's really how he runs his classroom, and it works great. That's not appropriate for every, you know, every educational context, but yeah, I totally believe in that, and I do think that putting video materials out there, particularly short ones, you know, 5 to 10 minute videos, hugely important and very beneficial.
If someone magically had this hand-wavy online course that followed the program that you're looking for, that was not just videos, but some type of interactive questions, that was the material that they could work through, and then a programming assignment, would you think teachers would use such a thing?
They definitely will use anything that you give them that is useful, right? Like, so the lessons that I see the teachers writing, they're pulling from all kinds of awesome stuff. They use Khan Academy, you know, they go out and they use programming lessons that they just crib from open source projects. Like, they are just using whatever they can get their hands on as fast as they can get it. So the limiting factors there really are just their time. You know, how hard is it to search for something, you know, and does it turn up in the first few pages of Google results is one aspect of it. And then another aspect is, what school did they come from and what resources did they bring with them from their teaching school? So yeah, like any of that stuff, they would totally be into it.
Thank you.
Yeah, cool. Thank you.
Next question.
Hello. I'm wondering if you ran into teachers that had problems with them wanting to do teaching but hit issues with the administration sort of determining what the curriculum actually is that gets taught, and whether or not sort of as an industry or trade there can be something brought to bear that can be data or sort of something to say, here's the value in making this part of the school's curriculum from the administration's point of view. Because if you may have a teacher who wants to do more, that they don't get to choose what's on the course schedule.
Yeah, that's interesting. I think that that does happen in certain states, the more advanced states where they actually have like a, you know, kind of solid curriculum. More the issue has been just keeping their job. amongst the teachers that I know. And so what they often need is local industry and parental support for the classes that they're already teaching. And once they have that, they tend to be able to add things and teach the things that they want to teach, as long as they have that community support to back them up, because their jobs are always at risk due to the fact that computer science is generally considered a elective rather than a math or a science. And so until that, so at the meta level, the big change that needs to happen is to start considering computer science a core credit, something that helps you graduate. And once that happens, then I think that, you know, we might get into this issue of, you know, exactly what curriculum is taught. Yeah.
So motivating K through 12 students to care. Why should a student care about programming? And so there's the obvious, let's make a game, but are there other things that would motivate a student to care about programming?
Jobs. That is a big one. Yeah, the thing about it that the teachers that I've talked to, like what they've said, is that motivating the students tends not to be the issue. When they want to have a diverse classroom, one thing that the teachers sometimes have a problem with is just finding diverse students. You know, they often only have white males in their classroom, and so they're like, you know, could I maybe have a couple girls or something? And so they're interested in trying to change that, but the motivation tends to not be an issue.
Hi, so I'm actually kind of in your position. My fiance is actually a first year teacher at NYC Public Schools.
High five.
Yeah. At a distance, yes. I actually did it. No. but I was actually talking to her kind of in the beginning of this year about trying to work with her school or do some sort of an after school program or somehow work with her school.
Yeah.
But then we ran into the NYC DOE and her principal not having any time and her, yeah, all of that.
Yeah.
So do you have any like tips or tricks or anything for how to sort of deal with these gigantic bureaucracies that move really slowly and are impossible to talk to?
The short answer is no.
Okay.
The longer answer is just route around them. You know, like one thing that's super effective is if there's a nonprofit already in your area that is that works on education issues, they typically have the contacts in administration and funding to set up these types of classes, right? Like in the Portland area, we have Free Geek. You know, we have a couple other nonprofits that are focused on tech education. So, you know, you can partner with them instead of trying to do it all on your own. Having a kid helps, because then the school is, sorry, I'm just like turning you on to breeders, but anyway, that was terribly derogatory, but anyway, but seriously, like being a parent in a school district or finding someone who is a parent in a school district to advocate for you is tremendously powerful, because the principals are very concerned about what parents think and are very motivated, sometimes disproportionately motivated by parents who are quite vocal. Yeah.
Hey, so this is awesome stuff that you're doing, and so good job. Well done.
Thank you.
And I'm just going to try to sort of kill two birds with one stone by proposing that to fix why they should care about programming and also finding these people is that what about just going out and not worrying about computer science curriculum exclusively, but also reaching out to physics teachers, reaching out to math teachers. We were talking in the booth about the IPython notebook, and that's the beauty of Python, right? It's executable pseudocode. The students don't have to know anything about programming. If you show up with a lesson that, you know, has some force diagram and all they need to do is change some numbers around and they're just running the code in their web browser, and all of a sudden, you know, it's this interactive demo sort of component to it, and
yes,
they're getting computing and programming as a basic literacy, right? It's like, that's why they should care, right?
Yeah.
It's not CS for CS's sake necessarily, it's to do awesome things.
Yeah, and this is a technique that Chris is using, right? Like, he's trying to map his curriculum to, Algebra 1 and get a certification so that, you know, it maps over. I totally believe in that model, and yes.
That's probably perfect that I'm talking right after that comment, because I taught high school for about 7 years, and I taught math.
Yes.
So I didn't have the direct responsibility of teaching something in computer science, but I would bring into the classroom a lot of simple programs that I put together.
Awesome.
And then kids would say, oh, that's really cool. How did you do that? Well, I don't have time to show you right now because we kind of cover algebra. But, you know, see me after school, or, you know, I can point you to the CS teacher.
Gateway drugs.
Yeah,
perfect.
Yeah, definitely.
Nice work.
So definitely encourage, if you're, you know, if you don't have anybody in your area that's CS, or anybody that's willing, you definitely branch out a little bit, because you'll probably find people, especially in the math and science, that have at least some decent basic knowledge of programming.
Yes.
That you could assist and say, you know, I know your resources are really limited, both in money and in time. Can I help you? You have any big questions, big hurdles you're trying to get over?
Yeah, I completely believe in that model. And actually, if you look at the people who teach computer science in the United States, most of them do not have any kind of computer science. Well, okay, I won't say most. Many of them don't have a computer science background. They're either coming at it from math or science, or in some cases, physical education, business, art. I mean, there's all sorts of reasons why a teacher might decide that it's important to have programming or computer science in their school, and it's not necessarily because they have a computer science background. So there's already this like cross-disciplinary spirit in most of the CS education in high school already. So yeah, I think it's a hugely important thing, and it's a good thing for all of us to realize that we're interacting with people who don't necessarily have a computer science background, and they're definitely willing to pull in all sorts of other types of things and make it really exciting for the kids.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
Looks like we have time for one more question. So.
Cool, thanks. I have a kindergartner, so I'm kind of new to the school system, but I would love to get involved. I have two daughters, the oldest is the kindergarten. So I thought a couple of my neighbors are programmers, and I think it'd be really cool if we kind of banded together and, you know, entered into the classroom somehow.
Yes.
Have you guys tried to reach out to PTAs or anything, or how do teachers feel about PTAs getting involved, or is it like overstepping, or?
I don't think that they see it as overstepping at all. Like, any kind of parental engagement is amazing. You know, like all the teachers that I know, they're super excited to have parents, you know, start up programs like this. And, you know, the key is to just have that conversation and be like, hey, like, we're thinking about doing this. We would love to have this type of a program. You know, what if we do all this work for you? What if we do this and we get the kids engaged in this and we kind of own it? You know, we'll check in with you, but like, you don't have to like take on a second or third job to make this awesome thing happen. We're just gonna make it happen for you. And I think that's kind of the spirit of engagement to have with it, because I mean, it's not true of all teachers, but most of the good teachers that I know, which, you know, are all of them really, they spend a lot of time teaching. You know, it's not a 40-hour a week job. So anything that you can do to help lighten that load, to help engage kids so that they're excited to come back to school every day, like, teachers are thumbs up. Yes, please do it.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
That was quite an impressive list of questions we had just then. So that's all we have time for. Everyone, please thank Selena for that talk.
Thank you.
And that's also all the time we have for in this session. So go forth and lunch.